Dear Dad and Sim, there's no time to spare and I have things I want to tell you, things that maybe only I can tell, to you at least. As I write, a moving walkway carries the world of people past me, slowly, steadily. I look up and they're passing, I look down and they're still passing. I look, I don't look, the world goes on. But when I look at the world passing by, something happens. It's special. It's not even just looking, it's comprehending. And sound, the scraps of conversation, the muzak, the savour of my eau de toilette, overgenerously applied this morning, rises from my sweaty body. The feel too of my abdomen, the bandages on my fingers, and the taste of my water, my dry mouth. Comprehending. I pull all that together in the moment in a way that's special to me, unique to me, to tell to you. And that's the world. I want you to know. I know myself, but I think there are things I owe to you that you don't recognise as debt. And I want you to have everything, just as I want to know everything, understand everything. I don't know if you want that or want to want that, but here it comes anyway. You are present to me now. And here's me getting abstract again. My first impulse in this travel pause moment is to share some of my wonder in this second so present to me. I will do that, I will. But I need to think out what else this is all about, now that I have the time to begin the doing of it all. And I'll end up probably back in the present, which is where I started just now. And so Dad, Sim, don't worry. There's more to the world than I've told you about so far. Sails fall, out of the ocean's swell, into harbour I have come, home. But I have left home. I have been at home there. There was a happy interlude. A lot of happenstance, but no real danger. A safer place than here. Innocent and simple, enfolding. Silent, but full of echoes, familiar and known. Nothing needs explaining, nothing needs to be done. But a struggle with circumstances. I go up to her to empathise, a crystalline clear view of dark gardens and sunset sky, a labyrinth of rooms. I wonder if he will be safe. We need to get on with our journey. There is a lot of coming and going, empty streets, the occasional cafe. I am upset at having lost it, being safely on the ground before too long, in the middle of a big rectangular space, a woman, something Spanish or South American, wrestling. I look for a bus stop. Climbing up vertical ladders, many coloured psychedelic phenomena happening in the wide air. She is crying, a wide face in the taxi dark, a place like a seaside town. The longer we looked, the more distant, higher, separate and endangered the vehicle was, the water having gone from the river. Big long leather cases, a room in the same hotel, the rocket with its bulbous end in the water. I do reflect that I don't work there anymore. The body speaks, momentous. It has weight and substance, soft, full energy, an image of rapture. A host of somewheres, not experienced unless subjected to recall and expressed. Memories are lost not because they deteriorate, I hold on to them like safety ropes, like an anchor, but because I translate into someone in another dimension. When the ropes snap, I am lost. I drift onwards, outwards. The rock pool, after the wave has withdrawn. Confusion casts its spell into day, solidifies and then decays, can restart but not return. No end, no motive force, strong like strong spirits. I have been away so far that I strain to be back here to make sense of all this. Each time it happens, I might not return. Till then, the hard stuff.
First, there is the world. Then there's the other world. The other world is where I sometimes lose my footing. In its calendar turnings, in its pre-invented existence, the barrage of twists and turns where I sometimes get weary trying to keep up with it, minute by minute adapt. The world of the stoplight, the no smoking signs, the rental world, the split rail fencing shielding hundreds of miles of barren wilderness from the human step. A place where by virtue of having been born centuries late, one is denied access to earth or space, choice or movement. The bought-up world, the owned world. The world of coded sounds, the world of language, the world of lies. The packaged world, the world of speed and metallic motion. The other world where I've always felt like an alien. But there's the world where one adapts and stretches the boundaries of the other world through keys of the imagination. But then the imagination is encoded with the invented information of the other world. One stops before a light that turns from green to red, and one grows centuries old in that moment. Someone once said that the other world was run by a different species of humans. It is the distance of stepping back or slowing down that reveals the other world. It's the dislocation of response that reveals it for the first time, because the other world gets into one's bloodstream with the invisibility of a lover. It slowly takes the shape of the cells and their growth, internalized until it becomes an extension of the body. Traveling into primitive cultures allows one sudden and clear view of the other world, how the invention of the word nature disassociates us from the ground we walk on. While growing up, I was constantly aware of the sense of all this in the same way one experiences a vague fear, yet can't distill the form of it from the table or the cup one is holding, or the skies rolling beneath the window frames.
Thank you.
I want you to know how the world is by looking at what we were told it was, it would be. In 1934, how did anyone know the world? Radio, newsreels, but above all pictures. Dad, this book was yours. This was, I assume, the world to you. A world full of wonders, but a world unknown to itself. Here was coming Hitler. Here was already the Depression. Here was the Empire about to leave the world stage. Here was war. The preparations for war, the reasons for war, and the world which would survive the war. All right, it fascinates me, but then my world was built out of this one. What did you think of it? Did it give you hope? Did it excite you with possibility? You were in adolescence then. The world could have been a motivation, but you didn't go out there to find it. You were a homeboy, but I think you grew up wanting some version of the world, which had, by the time we came along, been saved from fascism, for us. Maybe the steelworks, the broadcasting corporations, the agriculture. In the end, though, it was the dances, the art, the plays, and the travel which we claimed from you. Something rose out of these pages, something unknown, something escaped the disaster written in these images. The world is still here, and we are in it. Sim, it seemed to me that I've travelled and you stayed at home, that I went alone and you had your partners, your wives, your children, that I escaped while you faced the music. And who was the braver, the more adventurous? Maybe not I. But I've done what I've done, the pattern was set long ago. And I have wondered how it works that I ride and you drive. You cover as many miles as me driving. You have crisscrossed the native landscape, extending yourself in obligation and achieving a kind of moving centre. My centre's hardly changed. All that driving and being driven, it's preoccupied me a lot recently. Also, caring and being cared for, I think. So maybe you know all this I'm going to tell you. Then I really am telling you me, what I am. For you, Dad, you were always on the road. But this is to let you know what became of all that wisdom, those earnings, the share of advice, and, I have to say, the anxieties that you invested in me. I can't think of you watching while it happened, but maybe I should. I'll tell you anyway, love belatedly returned. I owe it to us to think about us as men, males in the world. I will dip into our pasts. I believe in the past as the road to the future. How much future do we need, though? Dad, you're beyond all that time thing now, free to be yourself again. Moving minds, all of us, whether we travelled or stayed close to home. In the end, we drove or were driven, and we were restless. Is that the masculine in us, or were we banished from home by the female principle? It's too big a question to answer here. We were gifted the world, that's all, and in the end, we all went out into it, sometimes together. We did, though, see different things. I would have to think whether I've seen the true world, truer than you've seen, and apologise if I've not. The world is always more than we expect, fuller and more overwhelming and more sensual. There will be pictures to accompany all this, pictures of the world still, the world going by, the world decaying, the world renewing itself. That's the moving pavement of it all. I should tell you about this morning. It felt like night because it was so early, but still the morning city, not the night city. The streets and roads not busy, the road, highway really, to the airport not snarled up. The taxi driver takes some odd turns down what seem to be side streets, revealing the old, the ordinary, the closed, in half shadow, doorways, cars parked under trees, corners which may not be corners. Then the road again, and everywhere, at intervals imposing on the scene, the new light boxes, concrete sculptures and sharply edged facades. Between all these, and the dark, which is really light stacked on dark, something happens which is lost. Take anyone away, and an illusion holds firm. Stop, or stand still and it's just a picture. But I knew that I know this moment, riding in a taxi. More than that, I knew I had been infected by it. Not to know where, not to know how far, but to know where to. Lost, but connected. A strange place, alien, unknowable, but known out of isolation. I've been here by myself, alone, even when with others, exposed, bare of securities, only knowing the light. Memories, recent ones, of the kinetic city, the articulate, imposing new, flames on glass, dancing stars, a light tower. Facades slipping by, nothing to take hold of, goods, surface. Why am I telling you all this? Do I want you to taste that lostness? It has a hard taste, a bit chemical, a bit dry, a bit dust, a bit fear. But once tasted, it can't be forgotten. I came to this lostness and I will come again, if not in person, in my dream. Where was it? Midnight in Urumqi, suburban Tashkent. Dushanbe when I was left alone. The bazaar at Bukhara late. Almaty after the opening. Ashgabat on arrival. Mary on the streets, especially Mary. Xi'an looking for a meal with Nicholas. Baku, the Caspian Hotel. Taxis, police cars, the occasional bus. Always pavement. So often, the kinetic city. Dissipates with time, with knowledge, but it's always there. To venture into lostness, it's like holding your breath and then having to breathe and then breathing. It's like ingesting smoke, nitrate. You say you won't do it again, but you mainly do. To see how far it is? Yes, that's what I wanted to say. Lostness feels like a dream, so it is a dream, and we can survive the dream life. Without the dream life, we are lost. Without dreams, without dream. So I mean that lostness is a dream, and without dream, we are lost at sunset. We need the dream dimension. If we lose it, we're one kind of lost, unconscious, lost to the world. If we connect with it, we're beautifully lost, lost in loss. I'll wonder at some point where the world is going with us. Yes, you too, Dad. With us in it.
The next day, we went to Lotus Mountain. After wandering separately, I found him on the terrace by the Buddhist statue. He said, as I took in the great view before me, in that moment it slowly dawned on me. I saw a landscape from another time and I knew. That was, I think, my moment, he said. A family slowly climbed the long rake of steps before me. Behind me, the irrefutably solid gold Kuan Yin at my back. The river of my dreams and desires in a stately panorama. Music. Talk, the slow, deep rumble of industry, ships. What did I know, he said. I knew this, my time, the 1950s, another time, I knew it. But, he said, some Inner Mongolians began a conversation. I gave them my email. I looked up. It was fading. A subtle veil of mist was lessening the light. The moment had passed, he said. Oh, the pain of transience. The laceration of disappointment. He seemed aggrieved. The most lacerating thing, he said, is to come up against disappointment. It is only momentary. Soon enough, we redeem even the most ordinary location with our interest. But on arrival, when the sheer, impersonal difficulty of it all confronts us in our tiredness, that hurts. We so want things to be kind, the stuff of dreams. We don't want to have to work at happiness. The unmanageable city and the ache of insufficiency. He is an expert on cities. His theory is that most cities have a greater. Los Angeles is one of the first cities whose greater is more important than it is. Los Angeles is an incorporated city of nearly 4 million people, a county of nearly 10 million people, and a greater of nearly 18 million people, covering 34,000 square miles. It is unmanageable, almost unimaginable. I feel the immensity of it all as an ache, and I am not equal to the encounter. I am lost, lost in loss. Drawing lines around something is a form of insurance against being lost. The sadness of indifference and the redemption of kindness. He shows me his diary. The penny has dropped. What was the Silk Road about, after all, but trade? Deals, negotiations, trading. The camels and the mosques were incidental. These are the bartering, buy and sell market lands, where the getting of money is a reflex. I am irritated by the constant hustling which entered the scene somewhere between Tashkent and Samarkand. I am not currently in the mood to be hard-faced. I need a little consideration. The cars throng the avenues and the fountains seem a bit mechanical. Then, later, I'm at yet another monument. A man is sitting on the steps. I am wary now and don't try to enter the small room. Later though, I approach the door and peer in, and the man engages me with conversation about the age of the building. I can see the interior details, which look interesting, when I step inside. We have more conversation, and I ask some questions. I step outside, and he says, "Entrance charge, 4,000 songs." I groan and put my finger to my head like a gun. He smiles and says, "You pay no money, you look," and gestures me inside again. I loved that man for his small gesture of flexibility. "That is you," I said.
Ever since my teenage years, I've experienced a sensation of seeing myself from miles above the earth, as if from the clouds. I see the tiny human form of myself from overhead, either sitting or moving through this clockwork of civilization, the huge ticking mass of it. And it all looks like something out of everyone's control, or rather, in the control of only a few. Those that made up the gears and springs of the pre-invented machine, or those that threw themselves from the tops of bridges and buildings. And with the appearance of AIDS and the subsequent deaths of friends and neighbors, I have the recurring sensation of seeing the streets and radius of blocks from miles above. Only now, instead of focusing on just the form of myself in the midst of this other world, I see everyone and everything at once. It's like pressing one's eyes to a small crevice in the earth from which streams of ants utter from the shadows. And now it all looks amazing instead of just deathly.
So here we are at the end of the world. For how much longer will we be able to travel, to seek it out? But here it is. Every time we switch on our computer, the world. Who needs to go now? So, Dad, Sim, we can share in the world now. I've told you about me. That is what the world has been about in the end. My world, not our world. But now it all merges into our world. What I now know I want to say is that Proust was right and wrong. He sips tea, eats a biscuit, stands on a paving stone, and the past falls in on him like a landslip, burying the story. I stand on a bus stop, and for a tiny moment I'm in Baku by a hotel, or glance out of a window and crossing by fountains to the expo, or eat scrambled egg. I'm buying reading glasses in Almaty. But no landslide, no burial, not for me. Each time, just as momentarily, I'm back here again in the other world. I'm still alive. Are the stars just holes through which the world shines? Is our consciousness a sieve through which our knowing drains into the beyond? Somewhere between my saying I would tell it and my saying that I said it, I guess I did. I said what I could say, I showed what I could show, I told what I could tell. The miracle of an analogy, as Proust said, it is our art which redeems us.